This presentation is a follow-up from the discussion we had back in November about water rates and staff's recommendation regarding water rates. So we want to talk about our current recommendation for a water rate increase. We want to share with you and also the public who may be watching, where does the money go, make that connection, and then provide you with an update on our five-year running projection for water rates. So our current rate requirement. A year ago, we were before you with our projections, and at that time, we estimated that we would need a 5% rate increase January 2014. We've updated the revenue and expenditure forecasts. New information that we've had, you know, we're a year wiser now, and we're reducing that recommendation from what we thought was 5% down to a 3% rate increase. That 3% rate increase is estimated to generate approximately $350,000 over the year. So why is the rate increase smaller than we projected a year ago? There's a couple reasons. We've been very active in trying to control our costs. As you know, we refinanced our water bonds last year, saving us about $350,000 annually, which results in about $7.3 million over the entire life of the loan. So we took advantage of better interest rates. We didn't extend the term. We kept the term the same, so it's not like we're just spreading the same cost over, so there is some real savings there. With those annual savings. We also we've been reducing our operating costs. In 2012 and 13, we reduced our costs by 4%, and we're projected to reduce our costs an additional 1% this fiscal year that we're in here. This is a picture of our 5 years history of our operating and maintenance expenses on an annual basis. These are expenditure numbers, not budget numbers, so that's actually what we really spent. And as you can see, last year, 2013, fiscal year 2013, was the lowest expenditures that we had, annual expenditures, in that five-year window. You'll recall we made some significant organizational changes, and we're just trying to be very prudent on any of our expenditures. And then lastly, we were helped out by having revenues exceed our projections for last year. As you recall, we had a nice dry and fairly warm spring, a dry, hot summer. Those contribute significantly to water use, and so revenues were higher than we projected. Generally, as a rule, we try to be conservative and underestimate revenue and leave ourselves a little room on our expenditure side. And that's true for all city budgets. So why do we need a rate increase if our spending is down and our revenue was up last year? Well, we want to stay on track for hitting our target of being able to invest $1.25 million annually into our system, and that's capital investment where we are replacing water lines that have extended their useful life, they're leaking, or we're addressing issues at our old treatment plant that are wearing out, or potentially addressing new regulations. So we want to be able to hit that target in 2017, so we're trying to take a gradual approach. And we think that predictable small rate increases are better than large unpredicted rates. You know, if we were to forgo rates for a few years, and we want to still hit that target, that would mean we'd have to make that up at some point with a very large rate increase. So what is the impact of a 3% rate increase on our customers? I have just examples here for a resident, your average residential customer. Average residential customer uses somewhere between 6 and 8 units of water a month. So if they're using 6 units of water a month, their water bill will increase $1.17 a month. If they're using 8 units per month, their bill will go up about $1.31 a month. So that's the impact that our residential customers see. So now, talking about where does the money go, trying to make the connection, tell our story of what customers pay, and what do they get for their money. So first, let's talk about what customers pay. So customers pay $3.20 per day for not just water, but both sewer and water. And I'm showing both sewer and water here, even though we're only talking about the water rate increase, because most people read their bill as their water bill. It's one bill. So while all these accomplishments we'll talk about is simply in water, this $3.20 really is what they're paying for sewer and water. And this $3.20 a day is if they're using 8 units per month. If they're using more, obviously they're going to pay more per day and less. The same, they'll see less cost. So what do they get for their money? They get safe drinking water. We test our water very frequently. I'll go into some of those details here later. We're regulated by the state, so we have a lot of regulations and targets we have to meet. We also provide very reliable service. Oftentimes I talk to groups and I'll ask them how many people have had their power go out in the last couple years. Usually several people will raise their hands. I ask them the same question about water. You know, in the last 3 years, when was the last time you turned on the water and you didn't have it? I have yet to have a hand raised. I'm sure people are without water at times. In fact, we had an incident today where people would have been out of water for a short time as we repaired a lot of frozen pipes on the customer side, but we had an incident where someone in a stolen vehicle was trying to elude the police and found one of our hydrants, and we had to shut the water down shortly to take care of that issue.
Good thing I wasn't home today, because that was my neighborhood that would have been impacted with no water.
So I recently read some information from PP&L. They were presenting the reliability of their service, and the local region of PP&L was pretty proud of their reliability because their annual outage was every customer would see less than one outage per year. I think it was 0.92 outages per year, and they were happy about that because that was better than the national average. The national average for people losing their power is over one time a year, and so I think Albany's record for providing water service is pretty good. The other thing customers receive is fire protection. Hopefully that's not something they're thinking about often. But when the fire department rolls up and they need to connect to a hydrant to put that fire out, they're able to get the volume out. We have the storage to feed that hydrant for a long time in order for them to put out that fire, whether it's an industrial fire or a residential fire. And then our system provides economic development opportunities. Because we have reliable service, because we have capacity in our system, as new industry or business wants to locate here, as residential development happens, we can serve them. So where does that money go? It goes into three main pots. It goes into repaying our debt. It goes into our daily operation and maintenance, and into our capital investment. So debt. As I said, we refinanced our debt recently, so we have an annual debt payment of just under $2 million, and that debt is anticipated to be paid off in 2034. How about on the operation and maintenance side? Well, this year we replaced 89 water services. We repaired 55 other water services. We installed 35 new services with meters. So that's a service all the way from our main line to the curb with a meter. We inspected and lubricated 1,300 hydrants. We repaired 63 hydrants. We replaced 4 hydrants. We know we have at least one that's going to need replacing as of today. And apparently there were 2 other hydrants that have been hit recently with the ice, and I'm not sure if those are repairs or replacements yet. We installed 176 new meters, so that's dropping in a new meter for a new service. We replaced 700 old meters. We tested 94 large meters. Those are two large industrial customers, LBCC, those sort of folks, and obviously those are important both from the city's revenue side but also from the customer side to make sure that those readings are accurate, and so we test those annually. We located and exercised almost 2,000 valves, which represents 25% of the valves we have in the system. It's important we know where those valves are, so when we have an emergency, we can get the line shut down and that those valves work. We repaired 157 valves. We made 27 water main repairs, and we repaired 127 water main blow-off locations. This here is a picture of a water service installation that the city is doing. You can see the little brass saddle on the existing pipe there. And I picked this picture because it shows some of the efficiencies we've been able to get to in the last several years, and that now that we have purchased our own small boring machine, so we can, instead of digging up across the entire roadway and opening up a huge hole, we can minimize what we have to dig down to, expose the pipe, put on the saddle, and then we can bore the service under the roadway. So that saves time, it saves money, it also saves the streets. Here's just another picture of a setup for an installation. This is a what we call a short side service. This is a picture of a water line repair. On the left hand side, you'll see that clamp on that water line, and those black lines running through there are power lines. Pacific Power used to own our water system, and it was often fairly common for them to bury their power lines along with their water lines. So that provides a special challenge for us here in Albany as we deal with that.
Those are primaries.
Yes.
And not 240 volt. That's 15,000 or whatever.
I don't know all the the voltage there, but
not something you want to hit with a shovel.
No. Exactly.
Yeah.
It wouldn't spark. It'd blow the shovel in pieces and it'd be gone.
What I'd like you to note on this is a picture of a repair. Now, the dark black and brown areas are actually the part of the pipe that hasn't been repaired. Everything else is a repair clamp. So this is an example of an old line that obviously for a while we were trying to repair, but we ended up having to replace it. That's part of our capital replacement, where it's just no longer economically feasible to go back and repair lines. Here's a close-up shot of a leak on an old steel line. You can see the pinholes that are created start leaking and they grow. This picture is a picture of an AC water main that broke, and those lines don't start with a pinhole. They fail catastrophically, as you can see here. And with failures such as that, obviously you have the potential for significant damage to adjoining private property, significant damage to our roads and other utilities. You know, they're a longer fix, and so you have to shut the water down for a longer period of time, and they're costly. So what else have we done with O&M? We perform leak detection on 218 miles of pipe. We collected and analyzed 631 water quality samples. So that's throughout our whole system to make sure that we're meeting standards or exceeding standards for water quality. We flushed the system at 43 sites, again, keeping the water fresh in certain locations. You need to get some turnover. We assured that over 4,000 cross-connection devices were tested as required by the state to protect the quality of our water. We performed over 1,800 cross-connection inspections. That's where one of our staff goes out and verifies that a test has been done or works with a property owner, getting them set up to do those inspections. We tested 61 of our own devices between parks and public works and all our other facilities that we have. We had 305 customer inquiries on water alone. We replaced 47 meter boxes. Set and pulled 63 hydrant meters, and those are temporary meters at hydrants that contractors and landscapers use. So we put a meter out there, they can use it. When they're done, we take the meter away and they pay for the water that they've used. We responded to almost 3,000 line locate requests. We did weekly inspections and services on our pump stations and reservoirs. We produced over 2.3 billion gallons of water. Here we have someone out doing flushing on a hydrant. There's leak detection, listening for leaks. Here we are taking a sample from one of our sample sites. This is at our water treatment plant, making sure that the water we're producing is meeting our standards. What else? We produced almost 1.5 million kilowatts of electricity this year. We repaired the canal bank with our own crews in 3 locations. We performed brush cutting on 30 miles of canal bank. We have an 18-mile canal, and so you have 36 miles of bank, because a bank on each side. We removed over 200 dead or dangerous trees along the canal. We cleaned our 3 debris racks daily. Here's a picture of the canal. As you can see, that it does require significant annual maintenance to keep the brush clear for capacity and being able to inspect it and see what's happening on the canal. Here's our crews doing a repair down at the Vine Street plant on the canal. And this is a control structure we have on the canal up in the Lebanon area. So how about on the capital side? What did we do? We designed and managed construction for 2 miles worth of waterline replacement. We did design and construction management for canal bank repairs that our own crews could not do because of their size or other restrictions. We did some significant work in planning for ultimate improvements that we have to do at Vine Street to meet water quality standards. This is just a picture of some plans. So our own staff, our engineers, produce the plans, the specifications. We coordinate, the engineers coordinate with our operations folks. They coordinate with the franchise utilities, the gas company, the power company, to make sure our projects aren't going to interfere. Then we put those out, the plans and the specs, we put those out to bid. And then we administer that contract. We make payments, we deal with the contractor, make sure that he's building it to our specifications. You know, oftentimes we're coordinating with residents and other customers out there as far as changing over their water or impacts to access to their property. Here's some pictures of the large line that went in on Hill this past summer. It was a very significant project, over $1 million. So the question was asked at the Planning Commission, how are we doing on water loss? This is a table that shows the last 5 years. And the trend, as you can see, in 2007, we were at almost 26% water loss. And in 2011, this report lags about a year with the state. We're just under 18%, so fairly significant progress. You'll see 2009, there's an odd number there that looks like we dropped. I'm not exactly sure. That could be attributable to, we have certain allowances for fire and construction that we apply every year per the regulations. And it could have been we didn't use that much for that year. I'm not exactly sure. But the trend over the 5 years is fairly consistent there from the 26 down to the 18%. So that you can see actual improvement from that capital investment, getting those leaky pipes out. You know, there's other ways too in which we're replacing meters, so we're getting accurate reads. Anytime we see theft of service, we deal with that. So we are seeing marked improvements there. What else? We manage water rights. You can't just dip into any creek, lake, or river and take out what you want. There are specific state rules about that, and so we have to get those rights certified. They call them perfected, and there's quite a bit of coordination with that. We manage all our responses to state water quality regulations and changes. We maintain a model of our system so that we can know what our pressures and what our available capacity is. So if a new industry wants to come in, we can answer the question, well, how much water can I get, or what's the water pressure there? We review all development proposals that come in to make sure that they can be adequately served with water, what sort of improvements need to accompany those developments. And then we also respond to customers who come up to the counter or give us a call in the engineering department. And I think this is fairly remarkable. We have 17,000 water or utility accounts. and we manage those monthly. That means we're reading a meter, we're sending a bill, and we're processing a payment on those 17,000 accounts monthly. So obviously, they're a fairly busy group. And you have people who are starting service, stopping service, moving in, moving out. You have delinquent accounts you're dealing with. So it's quite a bit of work on a monthly basis. So that's where the money goes, and I hope that provides a picture and connects what people pay for and what they get. Before I go into the five-year rate projection, any questions from council?
You showed us some plans that you make for internal use. Are those are you making those electronically, or is that still a paper and tri-square agenda?
No, those are done electronically on a drafting program, CAD. AutoCAD is what we use. Yep.
Good.
Okay, so the five-year rate projection. So obviously we have to do projections for both revenues and expenses. While we don't have a perfect crystal ball, obviously we have experience, and so we try to apply that experience. We do some looking back and then apply our judgment. But our revenue sources we have are rates. That's our big driver for what our revenue is. That's what people pay on a monthly basis for their service. We also get some funding through system development charges. That's largely development driven. As development happens, they pay into the system. Now, there is no general fund money used in the water, running the water system. So our assumptions in the budget here, we're estimating that we're going to have an annual revenue of $11.3 million for the fiscal year 2014, inclusive of this rate increase. Obviously, if development takes off or the weather changes, that could change that, but that's our best conservative estimate. SDC revenues, we're using an estimate of $220,000 annually as we look out 5 years. Again, that will fluctuate as development fluctuates. This slide should have been titled Rate History. So this is our five-year history of water rate revenues. You can see that we had a dip in revenues through fiscal year 2011, and because of the recent rate increases, that's starting to creep back up again, trying to hit that target of generating $1.25 million for that capital investment into the system. Here's our averages for SDC revenues. The five-year average is just over $250,000. But our three-year average is $225,000. So as I said, in our projection, we're using $220,000. That's fairly conservative. And if the trend continues up with SDC revenue, we'll modify that revenue projection in the 5 years at our next look. So if development increases, the picture looks a little better for rates. So expenditures, as we talked about, you have debt, operation and maintenance, and the capital. This graph here is instructive in a couple ways. One, first of all, the very top line, which is a green line, and Councilor Olson, can you see the green? I'm hoping. Okay. The first thing to notice, this is our debt service payments. The good trend here is you see they've dropped, and that's due to that refinancing. So we were up over $2.5 million. We had some debt that came off the books, and then our refinancing, so we're under $2 million. So that's the good news of this picture. The less rosy news is the second line down, the black line. That's how much rates is paying of that debt service. SDCs pays a portion and rates pays a portion, and you'll see in fiscal year 2017 rates is showing paying all of the debt service, and that's because with current SDC revenues, that $220,000 that we've plugged in there, we're projecting we won't have enough SDC funds for them to pay their rate share or their debt, their share of the debt, and so rates will have to pick that up unless some other funding source is identified. Again, if development picks up, that line could get pushed out. Ultimately, if development goes gangbusters, maybe SDCs will carry their share of the rates, I'm sorry, of the debt. So again, the target, $1.25 million per year, and we're breaking that out in general terms of about $1 million annually for pipe replacement and $250,000 annually for our reservoirs, pump stations, our treatment plants, and canal. And as I've stated before, that number can fluctuate. We may spend more on a large treatment project one year, but this is kind of the general target that we have. This target is significantly less than what was recommended back when we adopted the 2000 financial plan for water. However, we're recognizing the economic situation we're in, and so we've dialed it back and said that $1.25 million is what is the recommended least amount of capital investment to keep the system running. Variables that we don't completely control, rate revenues, as I said, weather plays a huge part in that. Development does too. SDC revenues, pretty much development driven. Personnel and operating expenses, we've done a pretty good job of controlling those, and we'll continue to try to do that annually. And then there's always the chance that you have an unforeseen capital need, a pump station that you don't anticipate needing major work. Something could happen, maybe a new regulation. But we try and keep on top of those and minimize those as much as possible and be proactive in our management.
People driving over hydrants.
That's right. So here is the rate, the five-year rate projection as of this year. On the far left side, 2013, you'll see we implemented a 2% rate increase last year. We had originally thought it was going to be a 4, so we came in under. But 2014, we had projected a 5% rate increase. We're recommending 3. And then you'll see for the next 3 years, we had thought about a 5% rate increase was going to be required, and we've reduced that down to 4%. And then we've added the new projections for 2019. 2018, last year, we just put something in so it wouldn't be zero, and we really should have put a placeholder for inflation. So that's a little bit misleading. But the news is, I guess it's trending. It's trending well as far as we're not anticipating higher rate increases. However, there are things outside our control that could change that. So council had asked for a look at comparative cities. I know that's small, so I have the same thing as a handout. So Mary's going to pass that around. And this is a comparator of 24 cities ranging from almost 600,000 in population in Portland down to a population of 845 at Adair. At times, people have said Albany has the highest rates in the nation or the highest rates in Oregon. And this comparison, again, it's only 24 communities. It's not all communities. Shows that while we are in the upper third, we are not near the highest. So Albany, the first number column after the list of the city is what do people pay in a base rate? And cities' rate structures are different. Some of them charge higher base rates and collect more based on actual usage. You can see Albany's 12th out of the 24, so we're right in the middle as far as how high our base rate is. I should point out, this is not just water. This is all utility costs. So for us, it's sewer and water. There are some communities that also have a stormwater fee, a street fee. Corvallis has some sustainability fees. So this is all utility rate fees. Albany, once you take your average customer who uses 6 units of water, we would have the 7th highest utility cost. You see some local communities, Lebanon and Independence and Adair, are higher than us. If the customer's using 8 units of water, Sweet Home jumps ahead of us also in cost. So that tells you where we are. As I said, generally we're in the upper third, but we are not the highest as we look at these 24 cities. So with that, entertain any questions regarding this presentation or rates in general?